and came in.
All of a sudden, Evan came down.
Good morning.
He was overnight by the way, we have the school line. So he said, "I'm right here." And she seems fine, now she's not there. So then she is taking more of it, said, "He's fine."
You're quite right, Doc, you're pretty good.
And then, 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 and then
There should be announcements on your sheet. I know there's a toy drive for the oncology. It's happening this month. Can you hear me?
No.
No. The oncology collection of toys this month for the, it's the X project this month. Of course, the ladies' luncheon is following the service, so anybody is welcome. And now, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever.
Amen. The kingdom of God has come near.
Repent and believe in the good news.
Let us worship God. And now, in preparation hymn, how majestic is the name on stage.
Thank you.
O Lord our God, we give you thanks for the grace that is at work in us through the gift of your baptism, the sign of your threefold name, the communion of your faithful people, the promise of your glorious realm. By the power of your Holy Spirit, poured out upon us in baptism, let your grace and peace grow in us until we gather at your heavenly throne and give you thanks and praise forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now the prayer of confession. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin.
Holy and merciful God, in your presence I confess my sinfulness, my shortcomings, my offenses against you. You alone know how to walk all sin and honor from your ways, in releasing your gifts and in forgiving your love. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am ashamed and sorry for all I have done to displease you. Forgive the sins of all who confess, and help us to live and walk in your ways for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Now, if you take a moment for personal silent confession.
Power and wealth, wisdom and might, honor and glory and blessing.
To the one seated upon the throne, and to Christ the Lamb,
be blessing and honor, glory and might, forever and ever.
Now for our offering, it's in the back of the church. From Romans 12:1, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Let us offer our lives to the Lord. Another prayer of dedication. Eternal God, take and use these gifts for your purpose in the world, giving food to the hungry, hope to the despairing, and new life to the dead. Teach us to live each day for you, so that future generations will know your goodness and praise your glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now we greet each other, please.
Let's stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. to St. Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 through 34.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus uses parables about seeds to describe the kingdom of God. Jesus also said the kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground night and day while he's sleeping or awake. The seed sprouts and grows, but he does not understand how it happens. The earth produces the crops on its own. First a leaf blade pushes through, then the heads of wheat are formed, and finally the grain ripens. And as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. Jesus said, how can I describe the kingdom of God? What story should I use to illustrate it? It is like a mustard seed planted in the ground. It is the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of all garden plants. It grows long branches, and birds can make nests in its shade. Jesus used many similar stories and illustrations to teach the people as much as they could understand. In fact, in his public ministry, he never taught without using parables, but afterward, when he was alone with his disciples, he explained everything to them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Thank you. May be seated. So today we're looking at a kind of interesting passage in that it really kind of summarizes everything that's going on with God and dealing with the people of God. But it's just two verses, three verses actually, 22 through 24 of chapter 17 of Ezekiel. And when we read them, you're going to go, what? How does that, everything about what God is doing in this very, very short passage, but there's a lot of context to it, and that's what we're going to discover. So start with verse 22. Thus Yahweh God says, I myself will make a sprig from, take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar and will set it out. I will break it off from the topmost of its young twigs, a tender one, and I myself will plant it upon a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain high of Israel, I will plant it. Then it may bring forth boughs and great fruit. And because a noble cedar, and under it will dwell all kinds of beasts. In the shade of its branches, birds of every sort will nest. And all the trees of the field will know that I, Yahweh, bring low the high tree, and make high the low tree, dry up the green tree, and make the dry tree flourish. I, Yahweh, have spoken. I will do it. Let us pray. O Lord, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, be acceptable in your holy sight, for truly you are indeed our strength and our rock, and our only Redeemer. This we pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. One of the things that's very important, so we'll talk about kind of looking at the oral Bible and say the way that the people heard these words as they first were expressed, is that, of course, and we heard that with Jesus, Jesus just does it in parables, right? And now we have this metaphor about a tree, a cedar tree, and I'm telling you that this has to do with the whole history of what God is doing with God's people, Israel. You say, what is all that about? Just three verses. Well, the first thing we have to understand is that this verse is in a place. It's in the Bible. It's in Ezekiel chapter 17. And before that, we have heard the story of how the people of Israel had messed up. Because that's really the point. What we're dealing with is how God calls people into being, how they mess up, and then how God vindicates that, works it out, makes it all right. So the process, that's what's going on. Let's try to understand what the plan is. So God had called a people to himself, and we call that people the people of Israel. Now the name comes from the name that God gave to Jacob. Jacob is the grandson of the father of the faith, Abraham. Abraham had received a commission from God, a calling, he entered into a covenant, and basically it's this, I will be your God, and you will be my people, and through you all the nations of the world will be blessed. Because, why? Because you're going to follow and do what I tell you. Right? So if you do that, then what's going to happen? These people are going to recognize that. And they're going to see the truth that you live in your life. I will bless you. You're going to become a mighty nation. You're going to become a great people. Not because you're going to have all this stuff and you're going to be like the other nations of the world, but rather because you're going to be wholly devoted to me. That's the key. Absolute adherence to God's way. Now, I think that this has been partially fulfilled. Okay? So I just want to say, it wasn't as if they didn't, you know, all throughout their history, they're kind of doing this. But there's been fits and starts, right? And so for a while, they'll do something right, and they'll do something wrong, they'll do something right, something wrong. And I know you've never heard that about people before. That doesn't sound like any people we know, right? Sounds like everybody we know. That's the way it works. So, he calls Abraham into existence, and then he gives Jacob this name, Israel. Israel means one who contends with God. What an interesting name for God's people. He's calling them one who struggle with God, one who argue with God, one who actually, in this relationship, is working this out. That's really what I think is involved there. And it comes from when angel, Jacob wrestled with the angel. So your name is going to be Israel, one who contends with God, one who struggles with God. And that's trying to work all this out. And then God gives them his instruction, his Torah. This is what you're to do. This is the people you are to become. And he leads them out of bondage when they found themselves in oppression in Egypt. Now, interestingly enough, you need to know this, the oppression that people find themselves in Egypt is not a result of their disobedience or their sin. But they do find themselves in oppression. They're slaves in Egypt. God delivers them to the promised land, the land that they are going to have and to be the people of God there, to establish this righteous nation. A nation that's going to live rightly, that's what righteous means, who's going to live rightly according to God's instructions. Well, you know how it goes. It's kind of a mixed bag. Sometimes they do it, sometimes they don't. But here's the issue. What kind of nation are they going to become? And the problem for Israel is they look around and they go, we want to be like them. Or, we want to be like them. And so they come to God and say, we want a king. We want a king. Because we want to be like the other nations. God says, you don't know what you're asking for, but I'll give you a king. So they get a king. And the kings are lousy. They're all bad. It's the most interesting thing. If you read the story of as it's unfolding, even David, if you look carefully at it, it's not all that great. Solomon starts out okay, he's got a great kingdom, but he screws up, and everybody follows him after that. There's only a couple that you could actually put a positive spin on. Most of the time, they mess up. Kings are bad. But most importantly, what happens is they start to think, because they want to be like the other nations of the world, they engage what I like to call power politics. And they're not going to win at this game, because they're not powerful. Now, for a while, they have a pretty good kingdom, and they have chariots, and horses, and shields, and spears, and soldiers, and all the rest. But they're never going to contend with the great powers of the ancient world. They're kind of a little lesser kingdom. Now, what God wants is what I call the Switzerland effect. If you know anything about Switzerland, it's absolutely fanatical about neutrality. Now, they can do that, right? Some places you can't do that if you're right in the way of everything. But Switzerland is the mountains, it's surrounded, and so they can do it. But they're smart. They go, we don't want to be a great kingdom extending all over. They say, we want to be neutral. And so for centuries, they have avoided war because they're neutral. So armies fight around them, but they don't go through them. So it's more complex than that, but basically that's it. So they have this fierce devotion to neutrality. That's only the people of God were to be. They were to have a fierce devotion to Yahweh. Not to princes, not to chariots, not to spears, not to swords, none of that. They were to be not power politics, but they were to be powerful in their devotion to Yahweh. Now, by the way, they actually were. 2,500 years, they have not had their own kingdom. Tell me, one of the people in the planet who 2,500 years after never having any land of their own continue to be recognized as a people. The only thing that keeps them that way, the only thing that keeps them from assimilating is their devotion to Yahweh. That's what holds them together. The mighty Roman Empire gave the Jews an exception, the only group that was given an exception in offering sacrifices to the emperor. It was never against the law to be a Jew of the Roman Empire. Because the Jews, the Romans were real practical, they said, we can't deal with these crazy people. They are not going to offer the sacrifices to the emperor, so therefore, we'll give them an exemption. And the Jews smartly said, our sacrifice to the emperor, will we pray for him? That will be, we'll pray for the emperor, and therefore, that will be our devotion. They went along with it. The Roman soldiers would not bring their insignia, their big placard. They talked about the Roman emperor being divided, that kind of thing. Their eagle things, into Jerusalem. The mighty Roman Empire would not bring them to Jerusalem because that's where the temple was, and it would be sacrilegious. It would profane the temple. The Roman Empire does this for the Jews. How is that? Because they were devoted. Now, guess what? The Roman Empire is coming to destroy Jerusalem in 70 AD. Why? Because they decided they were going to play power politics and revolt against the Roman Empire, and so the Roman Empire came and crushed them like a gnat. Which where they were, they were very important. But if they were devoted, they wouldn't have been, right? Well, same thing's going on here. So now they're going to get power politics. And so what happens is there's two kingdoms that arise. First, there's Assyria. That's in the 720s. And at 721 BC, so 700 years before Christ, Assyria comes in and wipes out the northern kingdom of Israel. And that had gone off the tracks long before that. And so the 10 tribes in the Roman kingdom disappear, by the way. Have you ever heard of the 10 lost tribes of Israel? That's this group. They're off. They're now part of history. And the only one that remains is Judah, along with Benjamin. Those are two tribes. So they kind of make up what will eventually be called Judea. So it's just kind of shrunk down. You've got just this place. In the middle of Judea is Jerusalem. That's where the great temple is. The temple to Yahweh. God of Israel. That's it. And the Jews start to have this idea. That, by the way, that's where we get the word Jew from. People from the tribe of Judah. So the Jews have this idea. Well, we got the temple. You don't have to worry about anything. God's on our side. We got nothing to worry about. We'll just go about. We'll do whatever we want. And that's the problem. You don't get to do whatever you want. You have to follow God's instructions. You have to follow Yahweh. You have to be devoted to Yahweh. Well, that's an issue. They never were really. For a while, sometimes they would do that. So now, Babylon comes. They replace Assyria. And the great king, Nebuchadnezzar, comes to power. So he goes into Judah, and he essentially makes Judea, a vassal state. So they can continue on their way, but their ultimate fealty is to Nebuchadnezzar. They have to follow his instructions. But over here is Egypt. And one of the things that they did, when Nebuchadnezzar came in 597, he took the king of Judah, a fellow by the name of Jehoiachin, and he took him to Babylon, and he put Zedekiah on the throne. And Zedekiah decides, you know what? I don't care about Babylon. I'll cozy up to Egypt, and Egypt will protect us, and we'll get rid of our connection to Babylon. Now, notice what's going on here. We're playing power politics all over the place, right? And guess who's going to lose? Judah's going to lose big time because Nebuchadnezzar's stronger and Egypt doesn't come through. And so in 587 to 586, Nebuchadnezzar comes in, he comes to Jerusalem, and he destroys Jerusalem completely. And he tears down the temple completely. That's the end. It's the end of the story. There's no more. It's the single biggest, most important event in the Old Testament because of what things come from. So if you want to think of that period before it, it's like a foundation or kind of the antecedent period. If you want to think of it as a colonial period or whatever, it's they're just kind of getting going. But now they're destroyed. There are no more. Psalm 137. It's one of my favorite psalms because you can feel the pathos. That's what's going on. They said, by the rivers of Babylon we sat and wept when we remember Zion. We remember the temple. We remember the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. We remember our great city. We remember that place that meant so much to us. And now it's gone. It's destroyed. And then, what do the Babylonians do? They say, their mockers come in and they say, hey, I tell you what I want. You sing for us the songs of Zion. And they laugh. You can sing the songs of Zion all you want. It ain't no more. That great song you sang now becomes a lament because it's so painful to remember. And the psalmist writes, if I forget you, O Jerusalem, may my right hand lose its skill. If I forget you, O Zion, if I do not prize you as my highest joy, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. They're wept for Jerusalem. They're painful. And what Jeremiah and some of the other prophets, Ezekiel, saying, well, here's the reason, you dunderheads. You wind up with the wrong power. You want to play power politics and you just get it. And Nebuchadnezzar is God's agent to bring destruction to you, judgment upon you for what you have done, for not following Yahweh. But, and now verse 22 comes in 17. So well, the first part of 17 talks about all that, metaphors. Now we hear this promise. But guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to take a twig from the mighty cedar. Now, that means a lot to the people of Israel. The temple was built with the cedars of Lebanon. A cedar tree is strong and mighty. It lives for over 500 years. Its wood does not rot. It has a wonderful smell. It repels insects. It's glorious. You put it up there and it's firm and strong and mighty. And the tree is majestic and glorious. And it towers over all. I'm taking that sprig, that little that tender shoot, I'm going to take it and I'm going to plant it on a high mountain. Now, if that wasn't enough of a metaphor, you already know that it's going to be Mount Zion in Jerusalem, where this wonderful twig is going to be planted, and it's going to sprout and grow. But he says it's on the mountain of Israel I'm going to plant it. Guess what was there? The temple was there. The temple that was destroyed. Now, God is planting a spring there, and it's going to be a mighty cedar. And its branches are going to spread out, and the birds of the air are coming to nest there, and the beasts of the field are all going to come and reside there. I think it's clearly an allusion to the peoples of the world who are going to gather in Jerusalem and acknowledge who is the king of the world, who is the king of creation, Yahweh, the God of Israel, the God of this people who were gone and done, now will be recognized by all as the great sovereign of the universe. All of the other deities that have been worshipped, all of the other deities that have been acknowledged as the great deliverers are going to be as nothing. Because they weren't nothing. Only this God, the God of Israel, who had called them into being, who had given them this instruction, and then now is redeeming them once again, he is planting this mighty tree. And then says something very interesting. And guess what? Every tree will know that it's Yahweh who makes the cheap tree strong or destroys. Going to lift up the brokenhearted, is really what's being said, and cast down the mighty from their thrones. In the wonderful Magnificat, that's Mary's song after she finds out that she's pregnant. And she's going to have this child, this mighty cedar, we might say, now by Ezekiel. What happens? The Lord is going to take that which is humble and exalted, and that which is exalted and bring down. Because that's what God is doing. God is taking nothing and making it something. Now, 3,000 years ago now, there was a king by the name of David. Did you know for a long time they weren't exactly sure? I mean, obviously, if you believe the Bible, you know, it was king. But we didn't have any outward confirmation. We now have actually physical evidence that David was a king. So David is to be the great king of Israel. Please name for me any other king from 3,000 years ago. Right now, just name it. And then his successor, Solomon. So they're basically 900, right? 1,900, those two kings, father, son. From this nation that eventually became nothing, why do we know their names? They're nothing. How many books are people reading that were written 2,500 years ago? Right? There isn't one. There aren't any. I mean, you might know a little bit. Aristotle, some of those other characters, Plato, the rest, they're from, you know, much later than that. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Moses, his instructions. Who follows that? But we won't go that far. Let's go to the New Testament. Let's talk about a guy by the name of Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus was from the city Tarsus, which is in Asia Minor. And at once he was a persecutor of the church, and he became the great apostle to the Gentiles. So I want you to think about any great writer. Shakespeare. J.K. Rowling, I think she does Harry Potter, remember that. C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, some other popular writers. And you add them all up together, put them all together, all their writings, and everybody who's ever read that doesn't come close to the writings of the apostles of the Gentiles, who's been read by more people on this planet than any other author, by far. How is that? Is that possible? Because he was writing about the mighty cedar. Who's the mighty cedar? Jesus. He's writing about this peasant from Nazareth who never even wrote anything himself, who becomes the mighty cedar that the world acknowledges as the great prophet, the great king, and the savior of the world. How's that happen? God can do it. And so you see in these verses, what we have is how God is taking something small, a sprig, making it into a great cedar so that all the world will acknowledge finally, completely, fully, that God is king. That's the enterprise. That's what we're doing. That's what the story is about as we look at this great story as we look at Scripture. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for saving our souls. Thank you, Lord, for making us whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to us your great salvation and your great cedar, our Lord Jesus, so rich and free. May your name be ever praised. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue then by affirming our faith in the recitation of the Nicene Creed. Let us confess the faith of the one holy, Catholic, and universal, and the Apostolic Church. Standing up. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Are there any prayer requests that need to be made at this time?
One for my brother, who's dead in the hospital.
let's continue with the prayers of the people. In the communion of the Holy Spirit, we call on the name of the Lord, saying, by your Spirit, O God, we pray for the church. Teach us to walk by faith and not by sight. With the love of Christ is always urging us on until your new creation is revealed. By your Spirit, O God, we pray for the world. Like the mustard seed of Jesus' story, let your grace be peace, grace of peace, grow in our world until all find shade and shelter in your love. By your Spirit, O God, we pray for this community. Raise up new and youthful leaders who will be good shepherds to your sheep, seeking the welfare of all. By your Spirit, O God, we pray for our loved ones. Answer them in their time of trouble, protect them from all evil, and grant them your heart's desire. By your Spirit, O God, we have many concerns, O Lord, that we lift up before you this day. We pray for Dave and his time in the hospital, and we pray that you would watch over him and bring healing into his life. We pray for Marcy as she deals with the pain in her leg. We pray that you would alleviate the pain and make her well. We pray for Frank, who is recovering from double pneumonia. Be with him, bring healing to him. We pray for Brandon and his, bless his life, we pray. And we pray for Donna as she stands by him, loves him and all that goes with the pain of that very terrible illness. We pray for all those that we name on our prayer list each and every week. We lift them up before you. We have prayed for our country and for our world, and we pray let there be peace. Thank you, Lord, for this day and for all that it means. Thankful for the ladies' luncheon and the time that they can come together and gather together and enjoy fellowship with each other. Gracious God, continue to pour out your power in the church, in the world, and in our daily lives, so all will know that you are at work among us through Jesus Christ, our living Lord.
Amen.
Let's join together in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God. You speak, and your will is done. You lift those up those who are weak and lowly, and through them you accomplish great things. Therefore we praise you, joining the song of the Universal Church and the Heavenly Choir.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is Jesus Christ, our Savior. Jesus came proclaiming the mystery of your kingdom. Like seeds planted in a field, spring springing forth in harvest, like a mustard seed growing beyond our imagination. We give you thanks that the Lord Jesus, in the night before he died, took bread. And after giving thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Same way after supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, this cup is a new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it as often as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Remembering your goodness and grace, we offer ourselves to you with gratitude as we share this joyful feast. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and cup. Make us one in body and blood of Christ, Jesus Christ our Lord. Guide us by your Spirit as we walk in faith, confidently moving forward toward new creation through the love of Christ that urges us on. Through the Lord Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we bless you, our Father, the God of glory, now and forever.
Amen.
And as our Savior Christ has taught us to pray, so we're bold to say, our
Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. The body of Christ, broken for you, the bread of heaven. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you. And be thankful. The blood of Christ, cup of salvation. Take and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with the spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace. Grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing Like a River Glorious. Be among you and remain with you always, both now and forevermore. Amen.